Hi, I'm Max, and we've been gathering a lot of questions on askmax@nature2.o. And here is one of them. We have another question here. It's if I want to participate to the hackathon in the Nature 2.0 track, I have to build a common. What is a common?
A thing which actually shocked me is that I myself, who has been talking about commons a lot, didn't see the commons in the world of today. I had Marlene Sticker of De Waag pointing it out to me, opening my eyes, saying, well, look around. If a neighborhood creates a WhatsApp group to work on their safety, what they're actually building is a commons. They could have asked a security company to let a guy drive in a car around the neighborhood. But because all the people are intrinsically motivated to have a secure neighborhood, they just can talk to each other and build such a system. It's as easy as that. Community gardens are commons. It's driven by intrinsic motivation. But also the voluntary fire department consists of people that think letting houses burn down is not a very bright idea. So if you start building commons, if you start looking that way, you are thinking about services and products for all the world to share who are owned by nobody or owned by everybody. The nice thing is there is a lot of research on that. So Ellen Ostrom devoted her life to it, even got a Nobel Prize for it, but also encountered the challenges by thinking in such a radical way. There is a law, which is called Ostrom Law, where you can feel that very much, because it is stated there that a system that could work in praxis could also work in theory. And that was a direct result of the debates she had with her colleagues, who just tried to point out scientifically that this kind of a commons, of course, could never work. And she said, yes, but I have them in practice. They do work. We just have to find the science with it. And this is, for me, a very good signal. It's a very good sign that this could be the craziness we are looking for.
That's an interesting one. You're talking about intrinsic motivation, and you're then saying that we think too much about what's in it for me. But isn't it linked?
It's not the question what's in it for me, because that is basically the question that states intrinsic motivation. All nature is driven by intrinsic motivation. We use the question what's in it for me to come to solutions of extrinsic motivation, of money, of depleting resources, of it could be free, but if you like it very much, then I can also ask you for money. What you see is that relationships that were completely natural a few years ago now become more and more about money. Where 100 years ago it was very normal to help each other because else you could not survive. The question now is, why would I help you? What's in it for me? And then the what's in it for me question turns the world around. I think people like to be heard, seen, and understood. I think it would be a great society to live in, and it would be beneficial for all. So it's a bit returning back to how can we help each other. It's a bit turning back to do not ask what your country can do for you, but what you can do for all of us. Because if this is a way we look at it together, we can change the world in a speed you cannot imagine.
Oh, that's cool. That's fine. I want to know more. I want to learn more. How do I get inspired? Where can I find more examples of commons? Where can I find ideas?
On Nature 2.0, besides the question session, we also have an inspirational session. And we are gathering there what people already research about commons in the world of today. Now you are rethinking the world of today, so you will find that you cannot follow it 100%, but you can use it as inspiration and build on it.